All right. So today is May 14th. This is the Lake Management Committee meeting. It's approximately 7:10. I'm going to go around and just ask everyone to just say their names. That way everyone on a phone, I have their names written down because I'm still doing minutes with pen and paper.
Eric Muller.
Yep.
Deb Harris.
Mike DeBay.
Okay.
Norm Taylor.
Mike Coombs.
Jerry Patrick.
Paul Murphy.
Scott Graves.
Dick Granels. Do you have any more?
Paul Murphy.
Yeah, okay.
Jessica Bishop.
So I had just a double check on that. Annie, I had Norm, Mike Coombs, Malcolm DeBay, Mike DeBay, myself, Scotty Graves, yourself, Deb Harris, Eric Muller, and Paul Murphy. Absent yep. are Ken Phillips and Rick Wylot.
And Daryl Sack is a guest.
Okay.
Jessica Bishop.
All right, so yeah. I have Daryl, hold on. S-A-K and Jessica Bishop as guests. And then also Jerry Patria from ConCom. Perfect. All right, I think we're ready to go.
Who's, if I may, who's Ginny iPhone 7 Plus? So we can put the right name on.
My wife's. I'm on my wife's phone.
So again, help me out. Who's I?
Oh, Scott Graves.
Gotcha.
She's got the app.
You're all good.
Okay, we got everybody?
All right, let's do it. For.
So we can start the meeting, yes?
Yep, let's go.
Okay. First order of business is our minutes from our March 12th, since we didn't have any meetings in April or the end of March. March 12th meeting. You've got the minutes in front of you there. You've had them. Any comments on them?
No.
Oh, all right. Hearing none, I'll entertain a motion to accept.
Eric Muller here. Make a motion to accept the meeting minutes.
I'll second.
Who was that?
Paul Murphy.
Okay. Yeah, I always have to state your name. Especially when you're talking, when we can't see you.
Okay.
All right. So, I'm going to do all in favor and we'll go around. I'm just going to do it by poll to say yes. Norm Cheever.
Yes.
Mike Coombs.
Yes.
Malcolm DeBay.
His audio's not working, so all he can do is wag his phone for yes. Wag your phone up and down for yes or nod your head. Oh, he says he actually can't hear either. I got a text from him.
Okay. He's in trouble. All right, so we don't have a vote from him. Mike DeBay.
Right. Yes.
Scotty Graves.
Yes.
Deb Harris.
Yes.
Eric Muller.
Yes.
Paul Murphy.
Yes.
Okay, that's unanimous. Okay, thank you.
Should I mention that we cannot hear Malcolm?
Yeah, I'm here right now.
Oh, he's got it working. All right. Yeah.
I just didn't want to hear Coombs.
How did you vote? Yes?
On I the voted minute? Yes. Whatever you want me to vote. How's that?
No. All right, let's go.
All right, moving on. Next on the hit parade. The next thing is 9 Beach Road. You've got there's two packages there for the reading file to go through. So I'm going through the first one, which is the one that had the earlier lake management meeting announcement, the normal one, you know, that doesn't have the Zoom. And so as we go through it, the first section is William Jenkins, 9 Beach Road, and you can read those. It's real quick. I can say is that that's held up. Conservation has sent a letter, as has Park and Rec, that he cannot put a dock there on town property until there's a series of legal issues that have not, he has not complied with. So they've told him no. So that's where it stands right now.
Dick?
Yes.
One thing, normally when we have guests, we try to clear their business first.
That's so right, yeah. Yeah, because
you're amenable to that. Why don't we try to do that? And yes. Unless the guests are just here to watch, which is fine, but if they have business before the board, then let's try and, before the commission, let's try and get it cleared first.
Good point. So we'll back up, Jess or?
I'm kind of just here for the, I heard that you guys requested the state to up the fee for the boat launch. I understand, but to charge me $8 the four to five
right,
times.
Well that's a whole, yeah. Right. So we'll hold that because that's on the agenda. That's an agenda item.
Okay.
Daryl?
I'm just here. I have no business. I have no.
No business. You're here as a friendly observer.
Absolutely.
All right. That's fine. Okay. Then we'll just continue with the agenda.
All right. Moving on. All right. So the Nine Beach Road, as I said, that's held in abeyance right now. Now, if anybody sees that dock go in, we have to know it. You know, that's at Nine Beach Road, right next to the town beach, on the town beach land.
It was not in there today when I went by.
Okay. So, just an FYI, the lake level right now is at 224.42. So that's really
nominal. Yep.
Good.
Yeah. All right. And because you'll hear people say, well, it looks really low, it looks really high. You know, it's right on the money.
Yeah.
Now, dredging, Canal Brook and Great Brook dredging. There's several emails in here that you can read through. I've been in lengthy contact, emails, voice contact and whatnot. Started out with the Army Corps of Engineers, has moved over to NRCS, which is Natural Resources Conservation Services. And it's actually becoming very productive. They have now asked for the flood information, which is really good news. We do have old flood maps. I mean, ancient flood maps when Congamon was basically all cottages. And so those same cottages are now, you know, $400,000, $500,000 homes and up that are sitting in basically in the water when the water comes up to the 100-year flood stage, which is about 5 feet above where it is today. So if you can picture standing out, looking straight out, and your nose is going to be in water, that's where it would be. So at any rate, we are creating those maps, updating them, working with the assessors, and they'll put values on each of the houses that would be flooded, each of the properties, businesses, anything that's in the floodplain will be listed on there. And that helps them justify spending federal dollars to dredge Canal Brook and or Great Brook.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be their project entirely if they do it. We don't have to do anything except point.
Good stuff.
So, okay. Does anybody have any questions on that? No?
No.
Okay. There was another one that came into us, 99 Lakeview Street. Not a lot of information yet, but they had two docks last year. Excuse me. It was recently sold. There's a new owner. They had two docks and four boats last year. This year they have three docks and seven boats, none of which are permitted because they did not provide the required information to conservation. So conservation rejected the application, sent it back, and they have not seen the new one yet.
Dick, can you just repeat how many docks and how many boats again?
Yes. Last year was 2 docks and 4 boats. This year it's 3 docks and 7 boats.
Yeah. Are they in the water already?
Yes, and Dennis was going out there to check it out. I believe today he went out there in the morning.
So, I mean, it's likely that the reason they didn't provide the information we require is because that would show that they're basically renting docks, which you're not allowed to do.
Bingo.
Right. And so he does not have, he did not provide any of the required registrations, boat registration information.
Right.
The docks are in the water, but the boats are not.
Okay.
Okay.
They don't have that many boats on those docks.
Okay. There's
quite a few.
Okay, because his application that he sent in, like I said, was for 3 docks and 7 boats. But unlisted 7 boats, you know, to be determined.
Yeah, so it's pretty clear, like we saw some email traffic from people finding stuff on Facebook. It's pretty clear that lots of people are violating the regulation and leasing dock space.
Yes. So
the point of us changing the LPP application such that you have to put who that boat is registered to is to prevent this. So hopefully that'll do exactly what we want it to do. So
right. So if there's nothing else on that, move on to the ramp ops. Now, as you see, as this flows from, there's a one from Fishing and Boating Access, a letter from Department of Fish and Game dated April 30th. You have a copy of that. Immediately follows the Desjardins 99 Lakeview Street paper. And it's the whole thing about the COVID-19 emergency, what's required, what you can and can't do, et cetera. And that has since actually had more information that has come from the state and from the Public Access Board. The latest of which, and it's in that one, it's actually the very first line under the COVID-19 emergency inland boat ramp canoe launch user guidelines. Says vehicles registered in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts only. And unfortunately, as we've talked about it here, is that 40% of the homes on Congammon are Connecticut homes. And the only public access to the lakes, they're both in Massachusetts, and fishing licenses are legal, either Connecticut or Mass can be used on Congammon. Yeah. And we've spent years working with Suffield, not just LMC, but, you know, DPW and all the other alphabet soup, cultivating relationship with Suffield. Now, all of a sudden, I think the folks in Boston forgot that Massachusetts has this little squiggle in Western Mass that is the notch, you know, that where we share the border with Connecticut. And it's made for already a lot of comments from people in Connecticut who are saying, hey, you know, what am I? I pay taxes, I boat on here all the time, I can't even launch my boat.
Oh. We've heard it from CRC as well.
Hmm.
So it sounds like, I'm not sure whom, but someone from the town probably needs to ping back to Boston and say, hey, can we have an exception in this area because of this peculiar situation we have?
I already did that. I sent an email. I'm waiting for, and I actually got the first one back. I sent it to Doug Cameron. He's the director acting director for Office of Fishing and Boating Access.
Yep.
And he has bumped it up his food chain. He's already got it to his commissioner and his legal people and asked them to bump it up to the EOEEA secretary and eventually to the governor. And so I'll check with him tomorrow to see if there's any update on that.
And we have a one of the first weekends with good weather is coming this weekend.
Yes.
Hey, Dick, this is Mike DeBay.
Yes.
That can't be a unique problem to us. I lived in New Hampshire for 35 years, and people use Massachusetts ramps all the time, and they use New Hampshire ramps all the time. I mean, nobody's ever, if it's been a law, it's been hidden to everybody and never been enforced.
No, I think the issue, I think the reason we're saying this is different is I believe the state's intent was to stop people from coming into the state.
Right.
So
it's a 14-day quarantine issue.
I don't think that's a mistake.
Oh, you think this is just because of Corona?
Yes.
Right.
That's why.
That's all it is.
I think that's not a mistake. I think that's the intention. I think the thing that may not be clear to them is that we've got this very unusual situation where our lake straddles the border and 40% of the shoreline is Connecticut, and the only public access to the lakes happens to sit in Massachusetts. So I think that is unique and unusual, and my guess is, hey, they have a lot of things to do. They didn't realize that.
Right, right.
So we just
Paul Murphy, something that should be looked at is that 40% of Connecticut residents are lakefront residents. They are on the lake and don't need access.
Well, they do if they want to launch their boats.
Bingo.
If it's sitting in their yard, it's not doing them any good.
Yep.
Oh, I have another person. I just want them to state their name so that in the recording we know they're here.
Okay. Who is it?
Mr. Didi is here.
Okay.
Where's the cow?
It's Joe Didi.
Thank you.
Hi, Joe.
Thank you.
How are you?
Yeah.
So like I said, the notes with Officer Fishing and Boating Access, and we're hoping to hear back that they can do something because, you don't want to put our ramp attendants in the position of sending somebody who just either drove, maybe a couple hours in Connecticut to get here, and who normally comes here, or somebody that lives on the lake who just wants to launch their boat, but happens to have Connecticut plates. And we even have Massachusetts residents with Connecticut plates.
Eric, that's you and me.
Because they have Connecticut homes as well. So it's kind of makes it a little messy. And like we said, I think in all of the effort that goes into this, that was forgotten. That didn't even occur to anybody. I bet you if you asked 50 people in Boston about the notch and what,
Okay. All right. So it sounds like we've done what we should do at this point. Now we're waiting to hear back.
Right.
I have a question.
Who's that?
Daryl Sack.
Yes, Daryl.
I live here on Berkshire Avenue. So I was on my way to work and I've seen a number of Connecticut boats. Now you're talking about the Connecticut people coming in and putting their boats in at the ramps and possibly, in contact with ramp attendants. But the ramp attendants aren't always at the what I'm talking about is the south ramp near Crappy Joe's. That ramp, there's been Connecticut ramp. They were full today. I was down there. When I came back from work tonight at 6 o'clock, a little after six, that ramp was full, practically full. And I, on my way to work, I noticed a Connecticut trailer with a boat, going to the ramp, actually pulling into the ramp itself. So, I mean, I know there is this stipulation with the state and the coronavirus, but for the weekend, yes, I would
say. That's virtually impossible to police. Basically.
Yeah, exactly.
Bingo.
I mean,
okay.
Yeah.
So in any case, I think we've done what we should do at this point, which is we've batted it back to the state and said, hey, we have this unusual situation. Can we have an exception? And we're waiting to hear back.
Right.
Okay.
I've got a question. We have Massachusetts plates on our car, but we bought a boat last year and we're still waiting to get the Mass plate for the trailer. So we be stopped?
It might be.
The boat's registered in Mass.
Boat is registered in Mass.
Yeah.
It turns out it doesn't matter where the boat's registered. The regulation is Connecticut. It's Massachusetts vehicles launching the boat.
Right.
Doesn't say anything about the boat. The boat could be registered on Mars.
Florida.
Okay, but what about the trailer? The vehicle is our car that's pulling it.
Good question.
Which is Mass.
I think that we even had this discussion, the chief, and I also talked at length with Doug Cameron, and nobody wants a war down there. You know, they said advise people, and that's it. Because if somebody gets in somebody's face about saying, you got to turn around and leave, we don't want a ramp attendant either maimed or shot or whatever. And the people are, you know, you get getting a lot more testy people when they're cooped up all the time. And like I said, if they drive 2 hours to get there and then you suddenly tell them, turn around, go home. Say what?
Hey, Dick. Yeah. Scotty Graves here. Listen, at the beginning of this subject, you said you were going to call Boston. So I think we need to expedite that.
I already did.
I know. That's what you said. So that's what we're looking for, a quick answer to get this thing in place.
Yep.
That's all.
Okay. Okay. This is Norm. The issue is, if we don't get an answer tomorrow, what do we tell the boat ramp people to do?
Hey, Norm, we can't hear you.
Yeah.
You came through all garbled.
Okay.
There you go.
There you go. It's better.
I don't know what I did.
Hey, you look good, Malcolm.
If we don't get an answer tomorrow, what do we tell the boat ramp people to do?
I know the answer to that. I know how I feel about it, but you know.
We can't, in my estimation, we cannot tell them to enforce it.
I agree with that.
They'll have to ignore it for the weekend.
Dick, okay. This is Mike DeBay. I agree with Norm on that, but shouldn't that go to the chief?
Which I've had discussions with Kevin already on it.
Yeah.
He does not.
We don't want to get involved in that. Then. Right. That's a legal issue, and you don't want to get involved in that.
Right. Exactly.
Right. So if the police feel that they need to enforce it, they should enforce it.
They are the ones that have to enforce it.
Right.
Okay. They carry guns.
Right. Our ramp attendants are not law enforcement officers.
Right.
I have got another question, Daryl Sack. Sorry. Is there possibly, you know, something that we can, like a sign that we can put on the ramp board, the boards, like the bulletin boards at the either boat ramps, and have them, you know, if they're going to use the boat ramps, that they that we have something on the Southwick public, you know, the public station, have a message on there.
It's posted all over the ramps. We plastered the ramps with laminated signs.
Okay. Well, I mean, as far as have them view it on like the channel 15.
I know.
Have something posted on there saying, you know, if you're, you know.
But if they're from Connecticut, they don't get our channel 15.
Well,
right. So the people who would get it are the people who don't need to read it.
Right.
Well, right. Well, I'm also saying, you know, if somebody shows up and they actually can, you say, hey, you know, go to this.
It's posted right where they come in.
Okay.
When they come in, it's right here.
Guys, half the lake is in Connecticut. Half the lake is going to put boats in. Come right. on, let's just move on. This is right. crazy. Yeah.
I'm pressed for time this evening, so yeah. I think Dick did the right thing. We've pinged it back to the state. We're waiting to hear back.
Right.
Bingo.
We're not going to enforce it. We're not going to enforce it this weekend anyway.
Right. The police may feel they need to enforce it, and then they will. Ramp attendants are not law enforcement officers.
I even had a discussion with an EPO today about that, and they don't want to enforce it.
Okay.
So they understand this area, and they do not want to get involved. So
Okay.
All right. How about we leave that one?
Yes.
Yes. Yep. And this whole thing, this whole COVID virus and staffing and whatnot, over the years, the min wage has risen quite a bit. And for every dollar that the minimum wage goes up, that adds $2,000 direct to payroll. And indirectly, it starts ratcheting up our other costs, our fixed costs that talk about porta potties, lights, phones, everything, security, everything that has a person associated with any part of it, they have to pay them more. So those fees have all gone up. So we went from where we used to have $10,000 to $12,000 down to $8,000 to $10,000 to $6,000 to $8,000, and each year it keeps going down. And this year we took a huge hit because we weren't able to start in April, where our biggest tournaments occur. April and May are the huge tournaments, and that's where we make our money. And it's where you make a lot more money per unit hour of somebody being down there than any other time of the year. So we are now down to pennies basically in our balance. And if we go into the end of May at $5, we will be negative before the end of May, be a negative balance. And the town does not put any money into the revolving account. This is strictly what our receipts generate that run the ramps. And that's the way the contract is with the state. The state approved, they went through all the numbers, through all the books. And if we went to $6, it would be next year, maybe not even make next year. It would be so close. $7, we would make next year and have to raise it again. At $8, it gives us margin, and hopefully somebody that, minimum wage doesn't ratchet up again past the predicted $15 an hour, not predicted, the mandated $15 an hour that it's going to. So we have followed it. And as I said, $2,000 a year just for
minimum wage increase.
Minimum wage increase.
So my understanding is the $8 may barely bring us to break even this year because we've lost a bunch of our time.
That's correct.
It should make us cash positive next year. And so therefore it should be something that we can maintain that $8 for some time.
Yes.
And at the moment, the $5 was started in 1995.
Right.
So we haven't raised the launch fee in 25 years.
Right.
Tell That's me something you can buy today that costs you exactly what it cost you 25 years ago. Right. So we are way overdue to raise this.
And the freedom to put a kayak in the water, still the same price.
Wow. Yes. Yeah, it's one price at this point. And right. And I think that's the way the state does it, right?
Yes, correct.
Yeah.
And the bookkeeping, then the reason they do that is it having multiple rates breeds a lot of problems. It breeds a bookkeeping problem. We have hang tags that are serialized, so we can track every nickel that is taken in at the ramps. A ramp attendant is responsible for logging by serial number each one that gets entered Each one comes into the ramp. They have to account for those tickets when they start and when they end. And so it's right now it's times $5 per ticket. And it's on a log. Everyone's written down. And right next to it is the plate number and the boat number. So there's a lot of information on there. But it's all one rate. And that's what the other municipalities in the Commonwealth that manage ramps for the state, they have the same thing, one price. Some are even automated where you just basically, if you want to go into that facility, there's a little box. You put your out on the Cape. There's two of them that way that are $7. You put your $7 in, and there isn't even a ramp attendant. And you get out a sticker, and you're good. If you don't have a sticker, they come by and they give you a ticket. So they're a little more aggressive. But again, it's one price for you to use that facility.
And I believe that at $8, we won't be close to the top. I think there are quite a few places in the state that are at $10.
We should go to $10. Mike DeBay, I got a question for you. Dick, it's Mike DeBay, I got a question. One of the suggestions we made to him was $10, go straight to 10. Cameron didn't buy into that 10?
No, he would not.
Why?
He did the math and he said, rather than see it doubled this year, he says, it should be able to get 4 or 5 years or maybe more. A lot, it really depends on what the mood is for minimum wage hikes and what the feds do if they mandate it, or what the state does if they mandate it.
Okay.
And if the minimum wage stops at $5 and pauses at $5 for a little bit, we'll be all right. But if it keeps ratcheting up $1 a year, we're going to have to look at going to 10.
Yeah, we'll be back here again in a couple of years. I don't want to waste a lot of time on it. I just wanted to know the answer because we asked the question.
Right.
So right. 8's the highest, so go, fine.
Yeah, and that's what they approved.
Eight is recommendation.
So let's do it. Let's vote on it.
Yeah, hey, Dick, Scotty Graves.
Yes.
In today's world, you're lucky if you can get a car wash for $8.
Yeah, right.
I'll make a motion. I make a motion that we raise the launch fees to $8. We know, and we know that our role in life is to be basically a break even. We're not in there to make a profit. We never have been. So at $8, if that's what it takes to cover the cost of operating the ramps this year, that's what we have to charge.
Yeah,
I agree. One thing though, I think Jess came here specifically to talk about this.
Yes.
So I think before we make any motions, we should hear what she has to say.
Okay.
I mean, I guess it appears to me you've already made your decisions that it's $8. I think that's absurd that you're talking about fees going up because minimum wage goes up. So your boat attendant ramp people are getting paid more. They can't keep math between $5 and $8 for two different kind of boats. It seems ridiculous to me.
It's but, all paperwork, Jess. It's not just that. It's two sets of tickets that we have to buy.
Yeah, I get it. But you think that it's reasonable.
That's
I use my
money.
Kayak 4 to 5 mm-hmm. times a week in that lake. And you think it's reasonable for me to pay that amount of money?
They take up a space the same as often take up a full length space. And if they do, then you'd be trading a $5 space for an $8 space for a $5 space.
You have separate
Murphy,
single car parking.
There's only one that's like that. There's only one space like that. The vast majority of car top launches wind up parking in a trailer space.
Right.
Don't let it happen.
At South Ramp, there's only one car top space. And so it would make it very difficult for the ramp attendant to then say, oh, well, you're $5 because you got into the car top space, but the person behind you with their kayak, they're $8. Because they're now taking up a trailer.
It's a launch fee. It's not a parking fee anyway.
Yeah.
A launch fee where I'm not backing a trailer down your ramp, causing any damage. I am literally picking up a 30-pound kayak, putting it in the edge of the water, getting in and leaving.
But you're still getting all the same services. And if we, here's the easy way to look at it. We've had the same request for an annual permit, a year-round And that is typically 50% of the cost. In other words, it's like a prorated how many times you'd use it. The problem is, there's several problems with that. If we lose money, because let's say somebody would normally launch 20 times a year, and the typical number that they use at the Office of Fishing Boating Access is 10 launches, so it'd be 10 times right now, $50, $80, and if what we're proposing would be an annual fee. The problem is, if the person launches 20 times, we're losing money on that, and it has to be made up somewhere else. So we'd have to go to $10 next year to make up the difference. It costs the same amount. We have cut and cut and cut. We even used seniors on the tax work-off program to staff South Ramp. So that's free labor, but we can't have them this year because there is no tax work-off program because of COVID. So we have to pay employees, which we haven't done for 4 years, for the South Ramp.
So just let me make sure, I want to zero in on the issue to make sure I understand what you're concerned with, is that it's not so much that the fee is going to $8, it's that you would feel much better if there were if the car tops stayed at $5 and the trailer boats went to $8.
Correct. I think if you're not using the reason it's there, that I know it costs money to maintain. I understand that, you know, that's a piece of cement that's in the water, but we're not even touching that, literally. Like, we're not backing anything down into it. I understand that you're saying you haven't raised fees in 25 years or whatever,
years.
But
yeah, right.
Yeah, I get it, but this, the impact of putting a kayak in the water versus putting a motorized boat in the water are two completely different things.
Yeah, and
you got a valid point.
And I definitely see your point. Across the state, though, all the ramps use the one fee approach.
Right.
So I would have to point out, Paul, that there's never been a difference.
Hey, guys, I'm at work. I got to go out on an ambulance call. Okay. Have a good night.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Jess.
All right.
Right, let's put it to a vote.
Debate. These are two different issues completely, and I think we should handle the issue Jess is asking a question about separately than the price of the ramp. Now, I understand in the short term it might hurt her, but it's really, we've never had two different prices, but there's no reason why you can't.
But Mike, the bookkeeping is phenomenal to do that. It really
is. We're not here to make a profit.
No.
That's not what you're talking about.
We're going to lose more. That's the point I'm trying to make.
Talking about logistics. So Mike, maybe one way to handle this is for us to vote on what's in front of us, and then we can bring up an issue to examine what would it take if we wanted to go to a two-fee structure.
Which right, I agree.
I'm not even sure that the Office of Fishing and Boating Access would let us do it if we wanted to.
That's fair.
So why don't we vote on what's in front of us?
Right. They gave us permission by the signed document to charge $8 across the board.
Mr. Grinnell, this is Doug Moglen.
Yes,
the Board of Selectmen were asked to vote on this because I believe it requires a vote of the Board of Selectmen to send this to them. And the Board of Selectmen tabled this to get a hearing. So before I think it needs due consideration before we just go through. I just wanted to get that on the record with you guys because we heard this argument. It seemed like it stood up. Like these people, you know, you're not allowed to just walk over by just past off the bridge where they've got rocks set up where a kayaker could just put their boat in the water and do it. There's a big sign, don't launch your boat there. So they go to the ramp, they do the right thing, they pay their $5, they don't use the ramp, they don't use the facility. So it seems, and some of these people go there for, that's their mode of exercise that they choose to do. There's a lot of merit there. And I have a tough time with that. It's a bureaucratic problem that we can't reconcile the paperwork. If we can help you with that, or if someone can help with that, whether there's, I don't care if it's technology or if it's, we need to print another book of tickets. Okay. But there's some merit to that argument. So before we, and this has to come back in 2 weeks to the Board of Selectmen to get voted on and sent back to go to the state. So There was this significant discussion on that, and that's why we tabled it to get your input and hear it. But I want you to hear from the Board of Selectmen that that was our discussion that we had. And we, you know, we had other people, you know, that had talked to us about this previous. And then again, even since we voted on it, I've got quite a few phone calls and comments. And I had asked Jess to come because I had heard that she was one of the, she's one of my most vocal critics when I'm on the, on a different side of an issue. So I asked her to join the meeting tonight to get her, her argument out there. And I don't think she's alone in that. So I just asked that you give it due consideration. Thank you.
Yep. And it, and it sounds like, you know, we do need the select board needs to vote on this. One thing to keep in mind also in the balance of fairness is that most of the time that somebody comes with a car top launch, they're going to consume a trailer space.
Right.
And so the people who now drove here with their trailer and can't launch because the car top took that up, it's sort of like, you know, sticking a finger in their eye with the, yeah, and they paid less than you would have.
I get
well,
it.
Well, then we need different parking, Eric. We need a different parking section for them.
I thought there was a, and I get that. And there's also a ton of merit to, I mean, someone threw out there of a season pass. That's a great idea for someone who's doing this four times a year. I get it. You're going to actually take, maybe you're talking about taking a little less revenue from the 15 or 20 people that do that. But there's a decent argument for that.
Here's another problem with that. We have visited this and we have spent endless hours on it. The problem that gets created is I come in, I have a season pass. You are already in line. You're next in line to launch and you haven't launched yet. And there's a line 20 long. I have a season pass. I'm already paid. I come up and I say, hey, I want to launch. I'm already paid. And you can't. We have such limited parking to begin with, and the parking, it was downsized by the state, by the Office of Fishing and Boating Access, then Public Access Board, to what it is today to meet safety requirements on the lake, not to overtax the lake from what comes from the ramps. Because yep. It used to be roughly 180 vehicles could park at the north ramp when it was all one big open area.
That's no different than Disneyland or Six Flags. If they're full, they're full. If you have a season pass and you show up at Six Flags when they're full, too damn bad. Sorry. Same argument for you guys, too. Disneyland, too. You know, sorry, folks, park's full.
Right.
Even if you're a season pass holder, it doesn't get you in. Right. So, I just think it's some merit.
Yeah.
Can I speak quick?
The one advantage to the
season pass, it would also take in, I'm sorry, Mr. Mueller or Dr. Mueller, it would take in more money because you may sell season passes to the guys that come every weekend that actually probably half the time they dodge the ramp attendant anyway because it's not man.
Yeah, well, there's that aspect. And then the other aspect, it's just like, you know, in the ski industry, what they love about season passes is you start with a chunk of money.
Exactly. You're right.
And you definitely have that money.
Keep in mind when you put your boat at Saunders, the average person uses it once or twice a week all summer long, and he's collected $1,400 for the privilege of putting that boat on a dock.
Right. There you go.
So okay.
I'm sorry to take this sideways, but I just wanted to get that out there.
So it sounds like we can vote on this, but until the select board votes on it, it's not happening one way or the other.
That's correct. But the one thing we also have to, the select board has to understand is as we go down the road with $5, we are going in the red.
Yeah.
Who's going to cover that?
Right.
The select board.
Yeah.
Do I hear a vote from Doug saying you got money?
Yeah, nice try.
Look, we get it. We also that's why we have this subcommittee, this ad hoc committee. We count on your advice, and this is all great discussion to have. You know, we didn't want to make a decision in a vacuum. If we had done that, well, first of all, Dick would have come over and killed me. Secondly, and then Dr. Mueller would have come over and killed me, and deservedly so. So we wanted to have this hearing. Unfortunately, we're not meeting next week because, you know, this issue came up in the course of the week. We put it on the agenda. We had to table it. And so we wanted, you guys had your meeting tonight. Unfortunately, we're not meeting next Tuesday because of the election. So our next meeting, I think, is the 26th. So that's the soonest we could get this in.
You can't meet before that.
I actually had thrown that out there to on another issue not related to this. And
you had two heads.
So Doug, let me ask a question. This is Mike DeBay.
Mike,
are we going to have a decision fee or a recommendation to you guys on what we do for two fees before you're going to vote?
No, I would like your I'm speaking, this is Doug Mogul, and I'm only one third of the select board, right? And we have to be careful. I know Joe was on, but we have to be careful because this is not a posted selectman's meeting. So if Joe starts weighing in, we got open meeting issues. But so I've been doing most of the talking here, but we'd like your advice and recommendation. You know, the select board, the other two guys may very well do something different altogether and mandate this. But I think your opinion is highly valuable to me. I'm going to take direction from you guys. But I think that the point of having a lesser fee for those kayaks, with all the caveats noted, is there. And yeah, there's not much I can do about getting you an $8 fee sooner than later. But this just came up, less than a week ago.
As far as
me being known about it in as on the select board, that I saw the traffic on this less than a week ago.
Okay, thank you, Doug. This is the first time we've talked about it because we didn't hear about it until now.
Okay, so we're all in the same boat, pun intended.
Yeah, but to hold everything up to make a decision on anything, you're kind of putting us in a bind financially. That's the only question I had. Where do we go next?
Where do we get that money?
Well, it means we got, as a committee, have to come up with what we feel and to give it to Doug and the rest of the selectmen. Well, so they can go with it.
Right. And you guys took it. I mean, you guys have been taking it all season because, I mean, COVID's got to, all your fishing tournaments and everything else. So you guys have been taking it on the chin all year. I get it. But you're talking about this weekend and next weekend, and then we'll be back to where we're going to, then you'll be able to do what you can do. So it's going to be a difference of $3 times however many boats the next 2 weeks.
Okay.
Right.
Hey, some of the dock fee money. Maybe we should get some of the dock fee money coming back to us. Help pay for the.
Can't do that.
No.
Can't do that.
No.
Good try, though.
I have a.
Nice try, Scotty.
Yeah.
We have a motion, though. We got to go back to that. We have a motion from Scotty to raise the launch fee to $8 per boat, one fee structure.
I'll second the motion.
Who is. That was Malcolm.
Malcolm.
Hmm?
I second the motion.
Okay. And hold on a minute. And that was Scotty made the motion. And let's go through a roll call for the vote. I'll go down the line. Oh, where's my voting chart here? Okay. Norm.
Yes.
Mike Coombs.
Yes.
Malcolm DeBay.
Yes.
Mike DeBay.
Yes.
Myself, yes. Scotty Graves.
Yes.
Deb Harith.
Yes.
Eric Muller.
Yes.
Paul Murphy.
Yes.
Okay, so that's unanimous.
Thank you. Okay. I do appreciate you guys taking it up and discussing it and giving us some direction. I appreciate it.
Okay, thank you. Where are we going with the other issue about considering or looking at how to implement two fee structure?
I would much prefer, instead of a two fee structure, us looking at a season's pass option.
Look at all those,
Daryl Sack has
on the agenda on a next agenda.
Good.
Okay.
Good.
Which is in 2 weeks, but that shouldn't impact, as far as our request to the select board right now.
Right.
I think what we have to do is get going. We can come back later and provide something that's a relief, but I think going forward, we've got to get one going with $8 as recommended, and then we can visit these things like season passes, like reduced rate for
car top.
Right now, we're all volunteers. We don't have 40 hours a week to devote to this thing. And we've got to do it to get off the pot,
All right, let's move on.
Okay.
Yeah, I have to leave Doug. In a couple of minutes.
Yeah. All right, the next thing, we've got ramp attendants. We've got a list. I think we're doing pretty well now. The only problem with some ramp attendance is, again, the COVID is driving some of them to, you know, they're concerned about high risk and catching something. So we're, Annie's working with who can staff when, and I think she's doing a great job doing that. Real quickly, next is the alum treatment update. Eric, if you can do a quick one on that. Yeah.
So I put together a presentation I gave to CRC, and I can do an more in-depth thing later. Short and sweet, things appear to have gone very well. So, you know, all of the measurements went well through the whole process. If we look at South Pond, where the biggest improvement was, this is the highest clarity we've ever measured in South Pond. And I've got data back to 1922.
Yep, agreed.
Okay, wow. So that's pretty big. The oxygen stayed up. The oxygen's very high, so it's going to be very good for the fish.
Yeah.
And as I have said, the real proof, the thing that'll really make me feel great, is when it looks like this next year. Okay. Yeah. But right now it looks very good and should continue to improve through about the middle of June as far as clarity. We may get a yellow bloom. This is not serious like cyanobacteria. We may or we may not, because the treatment that we put in is breaking down some organic matter that may allow a yellow algae to grow. That is possible. It happens sometimes after an alum treatment and then goes away. We might not. That's not clear.
Is the algae safe, Eric? Is it okay to swim and fish?
Depending on how expensive it gets, but yes, in general, that's not an issue.
Okay.
It's not like the cyanobacteria stuff.
Right. Okay. Good.
There's some additional measurements that I've agreed with Ken that we're going to do some additional measurements. You know, we'll do our normal monitoring and then some additional testing that we'll keep through the next few months just to make sure everything stays good. As it is looking good. People probably heard some traffic about fish dying. So the story on this is, the day before we started the treatment, the state came in and stocked with rainbow trout.
Dumped rainbow trout.
Yeah, so I'll expand. The stocking was done pretty harshly on the fish. And so when, in fact, I was there right after they did it, and you could see the fish were kind of flailing around and some strange behavior and what have you. And they had a tough ride. And then the way they got dumped, I mean, a lot of them actually got dumped onto the concrete.
Right.
But there were alarmed citizens who saw these fish dying while we were treating, and they said, oh, the treatment's killing the fish. So Ken went and collected up all the dead fish we could find, okay, and did a necropsy on some of them. Basically, it's an autopsy. And what we found was, number one, the number of fish that died was a little less than 10% of what they put in, which is, according to people who do this stuff, within the range of acceptable. On the high end, but within the range of acceptable, that's not unheard of. But the other thing that was interesting is, when we took those dead fish and cut them open, they had no food in their digestive tract. So it was clear they were stressed, they weren't eating. Unlike me, when I'm stressed, I eat. Fish are stressed, they don't eat.
They don't eat.
So it's pretty clear that that's what the story was. And if we looked at the dead fish, I mean, there's always some dead fish you find in the lake. And a pretty extensive search was done through all three basins, and it was predominantly the stocked fish.
Yeah.
There were, you know, like, they found one sunfish and a few alewife and a couple of bass, but that was, you know, that was just a handful, and you can find that at any time.
Right.
Hey, Eric, is the treatment complete?
Yes.
Okay.
Good. The other thing I would say is, I watched them. I actually saw them, and I videoed them literally dumping the fish. I've watched many, many over the years, many a time when they've stocked, and the two people that did it, when he backed down the ramp, I thought he was going to launch the vehicle in the lake to begin with. He was in such a hurry. And when they opened up the sluice gate on the tank, the fish dropped onto an open grate first. They hit that, and he's kicking them off the grate into the water or onto the concrete. And you know how rugged that concrete has that really aggressive V-notch on it? That's what they were hitting. And it was so bad, they even drove over one that was still on the concrete on the way out.
What's the next move?
You know, and the other thing, they crammed, here's another thing that has never been done before. Because of the COVID, they told us they basically filled the tanks with breed stock. So where they normally have just the ones that are going to be, they're this batch that are going to be put into the lakes, stocked, they threw in a bunch of breeders because they thought they were going to have to close down the hatchery.
Wow.
So just picture this. Same size tank, 500 fish, 500 little fish, 300 little fish, 200 big fish. Gets a little crowded. And they just, like I said, they were flopping around and a lot of them swimming sideways when they got in the water.
That's not Dick, can you complain to the Fish and Game?
Ken said we will do that. He has another project that they're doing. I think he finished it this week. And when that's done, he is going to write something to them about it. But he did not want to stir the pot create. And we got to do it right. You know, I think what happened was they had, you know, it's like the drivers that you've got for UPS, for FedEx, for everybody. You got a lot of people who don't know what they're doing and they just, things get heaved and they get dropped and everything else. And I think these two didn't look like they had ever stocked a lake before. It was just unbelievable. Sixes and eights, the way they were doing it.
Okay.
Okay?
So, yep.
Okay. All right. So if we can move on.
Yes.
Want to thank Rick and his guys, two guys, who put in all the buoys. We have two more to do because there was an anchor missing, and there's one right off the north ramp that I had two buoys moved over there today. And he's going to take care of that. And Saturday, we're going to put in the docks at the north ramp. And so correct me if I've erred anywhere here, but the ones that said they were going to be able to come were Mike Coombs, Mike DeBay, Malcolm DeBay, Norm Coombs, Norm Cheever, and Paul Murphy.
Yes, sir.
You got it.
We'll be there.
And myself.
We'll be there.
Okay.
I'll be there at 5.
Yeah, and Deb is going to be there at 5. She's gonna make sure people park in the correct places. Okay. So, I think in the interest of time, unless somebody wants to go through it now, we have. I think it'll probably be a lengthy discussion. Just to go through the LMC charter and mission statement. There's no urgency for that, unless you want to. I'll leave it up to you folks.
I really have to get going.
Yeah, let's leave it till next one.
Okay.
All right.
Hey, Dick, this is Mike DeBay. I agree with moving it on to the next meeting. I have some suggestions. I'll send them to you or talk to you Saturday for the agenda, because in this format, you got to trim it down to one package that has an actionable item so you got your paperwork in front of you, because a reading package being 35 and 40 pages long isn't the best thing for printing out when you're at home and trying to maintain it.
Oh, Well, that's we do it this way. There's another way to do it where we can actually display it online. The host
was doing that with a dual screen, and then it gets hard to keep track of who's talking when. So I gave up. I don't have two screens at home.
The other thing we can do too is we can we've done it with technical meetings. And the main in the center is where you have what's displayed that you want people to look at. And our pictures are all around the edge.
Okay.
Right.
So can we adjourn at this point?
Do we have anybody else? Anything? Excuse me. Anything? Anybody else?
I have a comment for Doug. As far as what Jess was talking about for the kayak, I'm not going to go into the whole thing, but one option for Jess, you can relay to her. I belong to Congamon Heights Association, and I pay it's $45 this year for membership for Beach One, which is on White Street. So if she wants, if she's looking to save money instead of having to put her boat in, pay the $8, four times, so like $80, she for $45, she can do it as many times as she wants.
They can also launch from the Old Town Beach, which people do. They walk their kayak down to the water, park up top, and that's free.
Well, supposedly there's, multiple. There's, I think, three or four beaches for Congamon Heights. So an option for her if you want to talk to her about it. Contact them, and, maybe that'll work better for her, and she doesn't have to park at the boat ramp.
And you can, like I said, at the Old Town Beach, you can park free and walk your kayak down.
Okay, so should I make a motion to adjourn?
Can I? I just got one quickie ahead of that. Scotty Graves here. Listen, yep. Curious. I'm still getting copied in on all the stuff with the Ludorf situation. It almost seems like the town's attorney doesn't care if he gets that property as long as they have access to be able to do what they want. Would that be fair to say?
No. All we have is that it's still being litigated, and you are correct in the sense that the town is protecting our interests in the road and the turnaround and the infrastructure that's in the road, but not if he were to get access to the water, it cannot impede town's use in any way, shape, or form for the road, for the turnaround, for the sewer, for the water, for the drainage.
Right. So what I'm saying is it seems like the town's attorney, because I did talk to him one time, seems like the attorney would say almost, we don't care if he gets ownership of the property as long as we have the ability to do certain things to the property.
That is correct. But if you think about it, what I just said is that his property is not going, his use is not going to be what he can do with what's up top. It's going to be a beach. That's what the town's position is. We have an infrastructure down there that's going to be preserved.
Right.
And he can't in any way, shape, or form negate the town's access or ability to repair, improve, or anything.
Well, he probably
I'm gonna have to drop out. Sorry.
Okay.
Okay. Bye.
I think we've covered it anyway. That's as much
good.
Oh. Do we have anything else, or can we have a motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Who was that? Scotty made the motion?
Yep, I made it. Yep.
Who made the second?
Norm.
And let's go down, quick roll call. All in favor, we'll go Norm.
Yes.
Mike Coombs.
Yes.
Malcolm DeBay.
Yes.
Mike DeBay.
Yes.
Me, yes. Scotty.
Yes.
Deb.
Yes.
Eric, I think, signed off.
Yes.
Yes. Paul Murphy.
Yes.
Okay.